So I have to thank the organizers for the opportunity to be in this great place and to take part in this interesting conference. So the results I will talk about are part of an ongoing project with Qidi Zhang, who is in Shanghai now, partly published, partly work in progress, and some tools are also in other papers. So let me recall for maybe less than half of the audience what is the problem of wave maps. So the general definition, this is not even the most general possible, because in some cases one could consider even more general target, but essentially the most general. So we consider maps between two manifolds. The target manifold is a Riemannian manifold. On the other hand, the base manifold is a complete Lorentzian manifold, so the signature is hyperbolic. And okay, this is a very weak notion of wave map. It's a critical point for some Lagrangian. The Lagrangian density is written there, so it's the trace in H of the pullback of the metric G. So in coordinates, it's very easy to see that it is quadratic thing in the derivatives, of course. And remember that the signature of H is hyperbolic, so actually this is a hyperbolic looking equation. The easiest way to feel the equation is to think of it as a hyperbolic version of the harmonic map equation. Okay, so this is a very natural generalization of the harmonic map equation, but of course rather different. And okay, maybe it's not necessary to advertise for them because they are well known, but okay, they pop out in several different theories, and including general relativity under some the assumption of the existence of some Kinley fields, you get wave map equations in some dimensions. Let us consider more concretely what kind of equation we have to deal with. So the standard situation in which wave maps are studied is starting from a flat Minkowski space, of course. So in this case, usually one should write RT times M. This is the simplest and best understood case. But let's say a flat Minkowski space, dimension N in space. If you expand in coordinates, you get a system of nonlinear wave equations, quasi-linear wave equations with a very nice structure. So gamma are the Christoffel symbols, and you get a quadratic form in the derivatives, which is a null form. This is sometimes called the extrinsic formulation. Why the extrinsic formulation is nicer from a geometric point of view, from a formal point of view, but doesn't lead to good, it's more difficult to work on it using this formulation, of course, but it's nice to know. So if you embed isometrically the target manifold into RK, then you can just say that the wave maps are the maps such that box U, the standard box U, is a vector always orthogonal to N, and U takes values in the target N. Okay, so this is the nicest way to look at the wave map equation, but not the most useful. So if the target manifold is realized as the zero locus of some function, then you get some very nice expressions, global nice expressions for the wave map equation. So for instance, if the target is a sphere, you get a very symmetric equation, of course, and here you see very clearly the null form structure of the nonlinear part. And a similar, more general expression you get if S, the target N, is the zero set of some smooth function. So you get always the same kind of structure, okay? So some function of U times null form. Okay. Oh, sorry, this misprint. In this case, when the base manifold is flat, you have a lot of results now. The theory is some parts of the theory are really well understood. There are some corner cases which are still under intense study, but especially two-dimensional case. But of course, the natural setting is the Cauchy problem with the two initial data. Here, it's not written in a very precise way. It should take values in the tangent space, the second data. But you understand, okay? It's HS, the usual scale of Sobolev spaces, and you look for functions which are continuous in HS and C1 in HS minus 1, and you immediately check that you have a nice scaling, which is given by this. So the critical space is HN over 2, the critical index is N over 2, and you have, you have immediately the natural expectations on the situation for this problem. This is completely standard. So the problem is critical when S is equal to N over 2. The problem is supercritical when S is lower than N over 2. You expect something bad to occur. And if S is larger than N over 2, you expect well-posedness in some sense. Okay. Actually, in the critical case, maybe one should put a question mark here, because it is clear that in that case the geometry of target and base manifold, in this case the target, should play some more important role. Okay, but basically this is the picture you expect, and this is confirmed from the local theory. So the local theory behaves nicely. So essentially, if S is larger, strictly larger than N over 2, you get local well-posedness. This was proved by probably the first application of the bilinear method in the context of wave equations, to my knowledge, by Klandermann and Majdon, and then perfected with Runyansky. On the other hand, the situation for the S smaller than N over 2 is not did not receive a lot of attention. Anyway, it's not too difficult to construct very strong examples of ill-posedness. This is written like this, but actually our counterexamples are in dimension 2, so target is the sphere. I didn't think too much after that paper, but I think it shouldn't be difficult to check that also in higher dimension you get essentially the same. Maybe not that strong, because here you can write two different weak solutions, but some pretty strong ill-posedness results. While in the critical case, you see that not everything is nice. Following work by Tataru showed that actually it's a good space, so you have you can construct solutions which are limit of sequences of smooth approximating solutions. But at the same time, you can prove that the solution flow is not well behaved. Okay, so you have some troubles. Okay, because and you can do this very explicitly. Anyway, so let's go on. The global theory is the nice problem, the interesting problem for the wave map equation. And so you have a good result for small data, and this is also expected. So if you have small data in HN over 2, and targets are reasonable, so you don't really need, of course, any special assumption on the target apart from trivial ones, completeness, because small data, they will only notice a small region of the target. So essentially this is what is expected. On the other hand, for large data, and this problem becomes already rather difficult, you can prove blow-up in finite time, self-similar blow-up when the target is a sphere in dimension larger or equal to 3. If the target has an open geometry, then it's more difficult, but you still can produce blow up. By the way, let me notice that low dimensional blow up if the target has a low dimension, I don't think anybody has yet proved the blow up for this problem. So this is interesting. Okay, anyway, so this is the general picture. There are many results, but this is the general results, say the results that say something for large classes of equations. The 2D case is especially interesting because the critical space is also the energy space, H1, so you have the question of maybe the local, you expect the local solution to be continued or not. So this is really the geometry of the target comes into play here. And so in group of results of several people, some are here, this is still studied, still undergoing the complete study. Anyway, for instance, if the target is the two-dimensional sphere, you have blow up. If the target is the real hyperbolic space, you have global existence, and there is some ongoing blow up classification, and code proved a nice solid resolution in the case of a sphere. So, okay, this is a related result, but maybe not relevant here. Now, let us focus on what is the corresponding to radial solutions. Let's say the equivariant wave maps are the corresponding to the radial solutions for the wave equation. And of course, it's a more general situation. Actually, from an historical point of view, this was the first case studied, this is the subject of this talk, so let us consider the special case now. Now, the target is a rotationally symmetric manifold, so you have a radial coordinate, and then dki 2 is just the standard metric on the sphere, S L minus 1. And you have this coefficient, so essentially the metric is completely determined by this function here, of course. So if you pick a different function, you get different geometries. And okay, you do some standard computations for the Christoffel symbol. So you in this for this kind of target, remember that the base manifold is always flat Minkowski. For this kind of target, the equation undergoes a dramatic simplification, of course. Let me just show you how to think about this this coefficient, this function g. So for instance, if you have a sinus, so a function with an under zero, you have a closed manifold, like a sphere. If you have a function growing, you get an open geometry like the hyperbolic space, so hyperbolic sine, okay? So the equivariant wave maps are maps which are completely decoupled. So the radial component of U and the angular component satisfy two different sets of equations. So you assume that phi, the radial component of U, depends only on, of course, time and on the radial variable on the Minkowski space. And chi depends on the angular variable on the space component of Minkowski space. And you get that chi has to satisfy just the harmonic map equation from two spheres, and so which gives some rigidity to the dimensions, of course. Then you have to pick L given by this formula, of course, and phi satisfies a nice equation which is just a radial semilinear wave equation, but with some singularity here, which makes this term critical. Okay, and the critical space, of course, is still h n over 2. So this is the equivariant wave map equation, and this was the first model considered, of course, already in the 80s. Of course, the previous results, the result I mentioned previously, apply to this equation. Still have global existence for small data. And actually, the blow-up results are known for precisely this this model, the results I mentioned before. You also have a global existence of large solutions provided the target is sufficiently open. So this is the Grillaki condition on the metric of the manifold N, and can be relaxed to this one. Okay. Now, this is the picture, a very spotty picture in the sense that I didn't mention the many, many results. There is a lot of ongoing work on the understanding of the blow-up mechanism and classifying the possible rates of blow-up. But and there are some more precise results, even for the small data existence, but okay. This was just a very general introduction. So now, the problem I'd like to address is what can one say at the same level of generality, so the basic results, when the base manifold is curved? You have a geometry also in the base manifold, non-flat geometry also in the base manifold. This is a partial list of results. Maybe there are others, but I mean, there are not many results in this case attacking in generality the problem. For instance, there is a stability of special solutions on all the result, but okay, this probably the results by Lori and others are the only ones which try to prove some results in more generality. So the first goal here would be to reprove the global existence of small equivariant wave maps in this setting, okay, in the equivariant case. Of course, this is just the first step, but I mean, already there are some nice there is some nice mathematics involved. Okay, so first of all, we would like to see precisely what kind of equation we have to deal with. So now we have two manifolds which both have rotational symmetry. The first one I call the function, the radial component of the metric H, and the second one, as before, G. And the equation becomes this one. Okay. So of course the R is replaced by the function H. This is the radial box H on the manifold M. Okay, so you see the structure is very similar, of course, but you have this difficulty because of the presence of this. It's not for seconds. The presence of this operator with variable coefficients here, and so what can we prove for this equation? This is a list of what we prove. I shall show later some explicit statements, but essentially this is these are all natural results. There are no surprises involved here. So what we prove is the global existence of a small equivariant wave maps in the critical space. The target manifold is arbitrary. The interesting part is that we outline a class of manifolds, base manifolds on this. The computation is not especially difficult to I mean, we can do this, we can reproduce the procedure on flat space. You have a dual, the usual version of the theorem with local existence with large data. This is a non-difficult modification. You have to work a bit harder to prove a higher regularity result because everything, there are some parts of the equation which are singular, so you don't get actually arbitrarily high regularity, but up to some degree. And this is useful because it gives you an unconditional uniqueness result by just improving a bit the regularity of the initial data. I will show you what we can do concretely. Let me also mention that we have some work in progress, but I still can't, I'm not confident enough to announce anything. So the 2D case can be done. I mean, it was just a technical problem. I mean, I think we removed it. And also, we have Strichartz estimates. Also, if the rate, the manifolds should be rotationally symmetric, but the data could be allowed to be non-radial. Okay, so You have to work harder, much harder for this, but it's possible to do essentially just with Strichartz estimate. But this has still to be checked. So I hope in the next 2 months. Okay, so this is the definition of the admissible manifolds. So try to get the biggest possible generality. It's a list of conditions, but you will see quickly that there is essentially a couple of conditions which are important. So first of all, I recall you that H is just the function which drives the metric of the base manifold. So I form this quantity here, and this is second derivative in radial, of course, second radial derivative. Okay, this 3 should probably decrease to 2. Okay, but anyway, so first requirement is asymptotic. So I require that this function tends to a constant for r large with a certain rate, a non-negative constant. Okay, this says that there is some convexity at infinity for this function. For instance, this is for the hyperbolic manifolds. This is n minus 1 over 2, to say something. This is really not. Typically, you check just by looking at the function. Okay, it just says that for large r, you have a certain number of derivatives decay like 1 over r. So typically, this is trivial to satisfy the second condition. This one is, of course, very restrictive. And here is the another restrictive condition. So first of all, the metric must grow linearly. So you don't have closed manifolds, certainly. This function must be positive and decreasing. Okay? So this is a global condition, which is harder to satisfy. But you should notice that, OK, you should see with the examples that actually this is really effective only on some bounded set. Okay, so this is an asymptotic condition. And this is a condition on some compact set, because it becomes very easy to satisfy for large R, as you will see. Okay, I don't know if this is very convincing, this list of conditions, but let me show you some nice examples. Okay, so you can appreciate that there are a lot of manifolds in this category, some of which non-trivial. I mean, so first of all, the hyperbolic space is included. It's easy to check. So you see, the function h is a constant, h infinity, plus something which decays extremely fast. And so all those conditions are easy to satisfy. The only one which is restrictive is concerns this. You have to form this function p and check that it is positive, trivial, and decreasing, almost trivial. Okay, so this is easy. But as I will mention later, once we have one manifold which satisfies this condition, we have an open set of manifolds. Okay, our condition is open, and we can quantify this. Okay, so let me show you what we get immediately. You can perturb HN. So instead of just hyperbolic sign, you consider any perturbation mu, which satisfies this set of conditions. So some derivatives must decay, like epsilon. Epsilon should be sufficiently small. So notice the following fact. This is, of course, increasing exponentially. So you see that this condition is is effective for r small, let's say, but for r large, you have a lot of manifolds. A lot of geometries are included. This one is really not a strong condition. Okay, so we have a whole class of perturbations, but I don't know if perturbation is the correct term, because at infinity, this is can be quite far from HN. Of course, the other test is if we can include asymptotically flat spaces, and this works easily. I mean, you perturb the flat space as H is precisely R, and you can perturb with something which decays, like a simple, and this is actually small, a small perturbation, okay? The reason why this is so dramatically different from the other case is that what is important is the ratio between this mu and h. So if h grows a lot, this is automatically small. Okay? But anyway. But of course, these are just the first two cases which come to mind, but you can, it's quite easy to construct a lot of examples which enter this this set of, we satisfy the set of assumptions. For instance, if you want to construct an arbitrarily growing hyperbolic, exponentially growing metric, you can do. If you want some polynomially growing matrix, you can do. And once you find, it's nice because once you just find one which satisfies the constraints, then immediately you have a lot of examples by perturbation, okay? Okay, so this is the type of conditions which we get when I say perturbation. So if H is an admissible metric, then any H epsilon which satisfies a set of conditions like this, actually you also need another set of similar conditions but without epsilon up to n minus 1 over 2. But essentially this is the restricted condition. Okay, so you see, it's not really necessary that this is small, but this is must be small compared with H, which can be big, of course. Okay, anyway, so this is the general picture. We have three different perturbation results which allow some freedom to produce examples. Okay, now let me show you the precise statement, so which is, I mean, what you completely expect at this point, I think. So this is, we consider the Cauchy problem for the equivariant wave map equation between two rotationally symmetric manifolds with this coefficient coming from the harmonic map equation. H infinity plays a role in the statement and is the limit which is assumed to exist of this quantity. Okay, so well, this is not a notation, this is a standard definition of Sobolev space, sorry, shouldn't have written notation, this is a standard definition of Sobolev space on the manifold M. And I also use this notation, which is a weighted Sobolev space of type LQ. The weight is this quantity. Okay, this in some set of coordinates that should probably be easy to write a simpler expression. But okay, it's not the point of. I would get rid of this quantity as much as possible. So there are two statements, slightly different statements, but essentially they say exactly the same thing. So the depending on if H infinity is strictly positive or zero. And so you have global assistance with sufficiently small data in the critical space. Okay, that's it. And of course you have the usual appendix. So since we use Strichartz estimates, you get an additional property of the solutions and also an additional constraint for uniqueness. Okay, so you can prove uniqueness only in this restricted space. Okay, in the case H infinity equals zero, you just have to slightly modify the definition of the HS, so meaning that there is a small part of the derivative which is homogeneous and the rest is non-homogeneous. This is technical and could probably completely be changed, but I mean, this is not really important. Essentially the same result. And this is our choice. There is not much freedom in the choice of the Strichartz exponents, I mean, which appear here. But anyway, probably there are other exponents that could also work. Okay, so this is the main result. of course, as I was just mentioning, you have this annoying problem that you need an additional condition for uniqueness. So this additional condition in some Strichartz space, and you have the natural standard question about unconditional uniqueness. So if it is sufficient, if can do there exist other solutions with the same initial data in HS in the space L infinity HN over 2. Note that, I mean, this problem was solved not too long ago by Basmati Planchon in the flat case, I mean, when the base manifold is flat. And the trick is just to go below with regularity. I mean, so you work in some negative space of negative regularity. I mean, it's just technical and it's a nice idea, but the idea is simple. The problem is that, I mean, you then have to estimate some nonlinear quantities in some norms which are not easy to handle, and this is more complicated in our situation. So I guess that it should be possible to do the standard unconditional uniqueness result also in this setting, but it's technically slightly more difficult, so we didn't yet do it. What you can do is, I mean, and this is just by implementing the same techniques carefully, if you just, first of all, you need a higher regularity result, but this is not difficult. So if the initial data are slightly more regular, up to a certain order which is determined by the singularity in the nonlinear term, then the regularity is preserved. And if S is, if the initial data are slightly more regular than the critical space, then you have unconditional uniqueness in this space. And this is not very large, but not arbitrarily small either. Okay, so not larger than 1/6, but okay. So this is also more or less basic results. And okay, let me just describe how it works. Since the situation is really simple, okay, because the equation is a radial wave equation with some funny coefficient. It's not too difficult to reduce to non-techniques. You don't use hard techniques, but still you have to work a little. So the first step is, this is our approach. The first step is proving directly on the manifold smoothing estimates. Okay? So this is a well-known way to prove Strichartz estimates. Okay? So first we prove smoothing estimates by some multiplier techniques. Then we change coordinates, so the equation is reduced to a wave equation with a singular potential. Okay? So this is the only annoying part of the, this proof. So then you have to prove Strichartz estimate for this equation, but since you have already smoothing estimates, this can be done nicely. At this point, you have the necessary tools, which are more than sufficient. You don't even need the full strength of Strichartz estimate, just some point, to prove to implement the fixed point method for the critical semilinear wave equation. You have some troubles because there are some singularities in the coefficient of the inside and outside the nonlinear term, but this is just, technical. You have to prove some radial estimates with the singular coefficients. It's not really a big problem. You have to work a bit harder for the higher regularity, and then you have to read the result in the original coordinates, okay? So you have to go back to the all Sobolev norms. And then, the rest of the work is essentially to construct manifolds to see how large the class is, okay? Let me show you, so this is the change of coordinates that you use to reduce the equation to this form. So essentially you get a standard wave equation, you increase the dimension by 2k, which is nice because gives you some better, in some sense, better properties. The problem is that this potential V is singular and critical decay, and you know that if the negative part of this V is too bad, too big, you lose everything. So it's, there's some part of risk here. And also here you see it's essentially, you have just a singularity here, but nothing intractable. Gamma is, so there is a linear part and which has been taken here, and then you have a cubic term, okay? Okay, so this is a cubic semilinear wave equation with singular coefficients which has the same critical space as the, as usual, n over 2. And this is what I just said. Okay, I can probably skip this. This is just to see the estimate. We can prove the full set of estimates with the exception of the endpoint also in this case. So these are the standard Strichartz, homogeneous Strichartz estimates with the usual condition of admissibility on the PAQ, and this is the inhomogeneous version. This is precisely the set of estimates we can prove. Okay, in some coordinates, let's say that you get some weight. Okay, let me briefly recall you that there is now an extensive literature on Strichartz estimates and dispersive estimates and smoothing estimates for various perturbations of the standard equations. For the wave equation, we need something which is a bit borderline, because V is a critical decay. I mean, there are many results on this, probably the first one by Bill Strauss. So then the first group attacking the case of critical decay was Burke, Planchon, Starker, and Tabitha-Zadé. And then we did some work on small and large magnetic potentials. Okay, so there are many results, and maybe I should also mention that for generic second order small perturbation of constant coefficient case, but small, Tataro has probably the best results. Okay, so the first step is to prove a smoothing estimate for the resolvent operator. So this is the Laplace-Beltrami operator on the manifold M, and this must be very very precise. Okay, so this I mean, it's easy to prove smoothing estimates with worse coefficients, but this is actually sharp. So here you have to work a little. Once you have this, by the suitable change of variables, you get also the estimate for the resolvent of your perturbed Laplace operator. Now, at this point, this gives you immediately a smoothing estimate of the following form. Okay, this is a standard Kato theory, but notice this is, of course, a Schrödinger operator, okay? The Schrödinger flow. But this is for free. I mean, once from this, you get this. So typically, you should work a bit harder to transform this in corresponding smoothing estimate for the wave equation. So after maybe the fifth or sixth time I had to do this, I decided to do it in general, because you can patch Kato theory. And so consider any self-adjoint non-negative operator on a Hilbert space H, any closed densely defined A. If you have a smoothing estimate for Schrödinger, you get this smoothing estimate for the wave equation. Okay, so anytime you need this, that's, you just can apply the Kato improved theory. Okay. Of course, in the case of the wave equation, you get some worse estimate. So this is one half derivative. Typically, A contains a one half derivative. It's a weight. The typical estimate here is a weight and a one half derivative. Okay, let's forget about this. Okay, once you have this estimate for the wave equation, then the potential can be put on the right hand side. I mean, it's just perturbation. You're done, okay? You have to work a little because of these annoying coefficients which give you weights which are singular, but essentially this is simple. Okay, once you have Strichartz estimate, this is just to recap the space in which you get contraction. I mean, this is more or less standard. You have to pick carefully the P and Q, but you can do after some tries, and you have to work in different spaces according to the value of H infinity. Okay. I think, okay. Let me just mention that the only annoying part in this computation is that you need to be careful when I mean, you need new nonlinear estimates for this quantity in the fraction of subalgebraic spaces. I mean, this is the only online part where you have to work a bit hard to produce the suitable estimate. Renato Luca, we had some we developed some theory for I mean, fractional integrals to handle, which handle also these cases. Okay. Okay. I think I can stop here. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. We have time for questions.
This is more a remark than a question. If you want to play with domains which are rotationally symmetric, you can consider, for example, if you replace sinh function you had for hyperbolic space by a cosh function, you would get a domain for which you have automatically global regularity because there is no center. So this would be cylindrically symmetric.
Ah, nice. I need some input on the interesting examples, of course, because otherwise you can just go in any direction.
How big is the step to get from radiality to general?
Okay, if you mean, same geometric setting, but non-radial data, this should be, I think, contained essentially in the method of Schottheim-Struve from 94. I mean, should work. I mean, we are checking the we prepared the Strichartz estimate in this case for non-radial data, so this should be the only essential tool, but we still have to check. Non-radial geometry, I mean, this is of course another story. Then you need completely different techniques, I think. This is just a simple approach, of course. But I mean, it's surprisingly effective because you get really a lot of spaces just with not too much effort, actually.
So there seems to be no more question. Then we have time before dinner, and thank you.